Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Emotional Craft of Fiction, How to Write the Story Beneath the Surface, by Donald Maass. Narrated by Timothy Andrés Pabon. Chapter 1. The Emotional Craft of Fiction. The world of fiction writers is a collection of opposites, factions at odds in their beliefs, values, purpose, and way of writing. Some authors have commercial intent, others literary. Some outline, others explore story in successive drafts. For some, genre is a badge of pride, for others, it's a hateful label. Prestige matters greatly to some, money to others, and movie options to a misguided few. A dichotomy less often discussed is the division between those who are comfortable writing emotions and those who find putting emotions on the page repellent. The latter group values showing. To get a reader to feel what a character feels, the thinking goes, put the reader through a character's experience. Provoke emotions in readers. Don't spoon-feed them feelings. Most valuable of all to this group is the capturing of moments. These are passages so honest, vivid, and true that they transcend mere words. Readers recognize the universal human condition. For other writers, telling is a positive. They go inside the mind and heart of a character to observe and feel story events just as that character does. Writing out characters' emotions is the essence of intimate storytelling. How else can you bring a character fully alive? For these authors, the highest expression of the art are passages of extended telling, in which a character's inward condition is captured in nuanced detail by means of words alone. While few authors are purists of showing or telling, most lean more in one direction or the other. Even so, most agree that showing is better than telling, in general, and most blend the two. There isn't much debate of the topic. When it comes up at writers' conferences, the issue is usually framed as a question. What's the right balance between showing and telling? Having researched, studied, and taught the handling of emotions in fiction, I have reached an altogether different conclusion. Fiction writers are asking the wrong question. Showing and telling are fine as far as they go, but the emotional experience of readers has little to do with that. The most useful question is not, how can I get across what characters are going through? The better question is, how can I get readers to go on emotional journeys of their own? Showing and telling are only part of the picture, but they are not even the most important part. As we will discover, readers may believe that they're living a story along with its characters. Actually, they're not. Readers are having their own experience that is merely occasioned by what's on the page. That experience can be elicited or not by any number of story elements: plot, setting, theme, mood, dialogue, and yes, what characters themselves feel. What the novelist is doing, though, is not causing readers to feel as the novelist does or as his characters do, but rather inducing for each reader a unique emotional journey through a story. When you think about it, this makes perfect sense. No two readers read a novel the same way. How could they possibly? To see how differently folks experience a work of fiction, check their comments on Goodreads. Are those people all reading the same novel? The purpose of this book is to delve into the ways and means of creating a powerful emotional experience for readers as they read. We'll discuss effective ways of showing and telling naturally, but there's much more to it than that. The dynamics of reader responses are complex. Equally complex and as varied in their effect are character arcs, journeys of self-discovery, which in turn cannot happen without ongoing emotional struggle. The language of emotion in a novel also makes a difference to readers' experiences. Plot, too, can be understood as a sequence of emotional milestones. As a writer, you are on an emotional journey as you write, as well, a journey that informs and influences not only the story you are creating, but also your voice and very identity as a writer. Why is it important to look at fiction writing through the lens of emotional experience? Because that's the way readers read. They don't so much read as respond. They do not automatically adopt your outlook and outrage. They formulate their own. You are not the author of what readers feel, just the provocateur of those feelings. You may curate your character's experiences and put them on display, but the exhibit's meaning is different in thousands of ways for thousands of different museum visitors, your readers. Not every published novel creates a powerful emotional experience for readers. In the slush pile, the conditions are even worse. Too many manuscripts provoke very little feeling at all. The sad truth is that television commercials can stir more feelings in 30 seconds than many manuscripts do in 300 pages. How many novels have moved you to tears, rage, and a resolution to live differently? How many have left a permanent mark, branding you with a story that you will never forget? The number probably isn't great, and of that small number, I suspect most of your memorable choices are not current novels, but classics. What makes them classics? Artful storytelling, sure, but beyond the storytelling, classics have enduring appeal mostly because we remember the experiences we had while reading them. We remember not the art, but the impact. When a plot resolves, readers are satisfied. But what they remember of a novel is what they felt while reading it. Hooks may hook, twists may intrigue, tension may turn pages, and prose may dazzle. But all of those effects fade as quickly as fireworks in a night sky. Ask readers what they best remember about novels, and most will say the characters. But is that accurate? It's true that characters become real to us, but that is because of what they cause us to feel. Characters aren't actually real. Only our own feelings are. Emotional impact is not an extra. It's as fundamental to a novel's purpose and structure as its plot. The emotional craft of fiction underlies the creation of character arcs, plot turns, beginnings, midpoints, endings, and strong scenes. It is the basis of voice. The emotional craft of fiction also can unlock the power of writing personally, reconnecting you to your story during those chaotic times when your novel falls to pieces and your sense of fun is gone. Emotional craft isn't a repackaging of old writing bromides. It's a way of understanding what causes emotional impact on readers and deliberately using those methods. It's a way to energize your writing with tools that are always available, your own feelings. The methods in this book do not depend on plot formulas or scene checklists. They do not reduce the process to accidental discovery or luck. Being born with the unreliable gift of native genius won't help. Mastering the emotional craft of fiction starts with understanding how emotional impact is produced and then applying that in practice. It isn't magic, but the results will feel magical. The mastery of this craft will not change your story type, style, or intent. It doesn't matter whether you're commercial or literary, pantsing or plotting, or working in a genre, mashing genres up, or blazing a trail. All manuscripts, as I said, need to make readers feel more, and the methods for doing that are set out for you here. I have already written several successful books on fiction craft, so why this new approach? What makes it different? Why is it better? Why is it even necessary? For me, emotional craft became a necessary study because I realized that in reading many manuscripts and also published novels, I was feeling little. The high action of best-selling thrillers often left me cold. Speculative fiction engaged my imagination, but did not often touch my soul. Romance and women's fiction wallowed in feelings, but frequently left me feeling indifferent. Literary fiction can be the driest reading experience of all. Beautiful writing may sparkle like a diamond necklace, but sparkling isn't a feeling. The greatest wish of editors today is a strong voice. And that's fine, but even strong voices can fail to reach my heart. Strong writing doesn't automatically produce strong feelings. Paradoxically, poorly written novels can sometimes unsettle me, stir me to anger, or send me reaching for a tissue. I want to feel more as I read, don't you? That's why this book and the methods herein matter. When readers feel strongly, Their hearts are open. Your stories can not only reach them for a moment, but they can change them forever. I don't care about what you write, how you write it, your choices in publishing, or what you want out of your career. What I want is to feel deeply as I read your work. I want to feel connected to you and your characters in the way I do to the most memorable classics and the most stunning new titles I'll read this year. Does that goal sound good to you? I hope so. The book ahead is a guide for how to get there. Chapter 2. Inner versus Outer. There are three primary paths to producing an emotional response in readers. The first is to report what characters are feeling so effectively that readers feel something too. This is inner mode, the telling of emotions. As though talking with friends over coffee, we nod, furrow our brows, gasp, protest, wonder, and ask questions as if the character's feelings were our own. The second is to provoke in readers what characters may be feeling by implying their inner state through external action. This is outer mode, the showing of emotions. Like billiard balls colliding, the theory goes, a character's actions transfer an emotional impact to the reader, who feels it with equal force, and the reader caroms across the table. There's no description of the feeling, we simply roll with it. The third method is to cause readers to feel something that a story's characters do not themselves feel. This is other mode, an emotional dialogue between author and reader. The reader reacts, resists, and sometimes succumbs, but thanks to the author's skill, she can never escape the churn and flow of her own feelings. All three paths to producing emotional responses in readers are valid, but all three have pitfalls and can fail to work. To successfully use each, it's necessary to understand why each is effective when it is. Once you know the underlying cause behind the surface effects, you'll know whether the approach that you are taking on a given page will reliably move readers' hearts. Outer mode, showing. The choice between inner and outer modes is a central one. Some story types, such as romance fiction, necessarily rely on inner mode. Others, like thrillers, either have no time to dwell on characters' feelings, or their authors regard such passages as artless and possibly repellent. Writers of women's fiction are caught in the middle. Given this story type and its audience, you'd think this wouldn't be much of an issue. In women's fiction, it's the inner experience of characters that we want to read, right? Changes and growth are the story. A journey of transformation is mostly taken inside, so inner mode would seem to be the default mode of choice. On the other hand, women's fiction writers usually hope to do more than entertain. Their fiction may be warm, fun, and loaded with chocolate and recipes, but it's also serious. It has something to say. It ought to be well written, for how else will you win starred reviews and hope to raise questions for book clubs to discuss? Such artfulness requires showing. Yet outer moments in many manuscripts can feel small and self-consciously written. In other words, arty more than artful. How can that be? Nothing is more valid and vivid than what we can see and hear, right? Human action is also driven by need. That need is sensed in subtext and revealed through what people say and do. That, in turn, should stir our own imaginations and churn up our feelings. Shouldn't it? That's not really true. When outward actions stir us, it's not the actions we read that have stirred us, but that we have stirred ourselves. Action is an opportunity for us to feel something, not a cause of feeling something. The distinction matters. It explains that when showing works, the thing we should look at is not why it works, but when. Matthew Quick's The Silver Linings Playbook, 2008, is a novel featuring a protagonist, Pat Peoples, who is certifiably crazy. Pat begins the novel in a neural health facility from which he is released with the help of his mother. Quick knows the trick of making a mentally ill protagonist enjoyable to read about. Make him funny. Pat Peoples amusingly refuses to give up his dream of reuniting with his estranged wife, Nikki, and is convinced that their apart-time, as he calls it, will end. All evidence is to the contrary, of course, as we see when Pat returns home. When I finally come out of the basement, I notice that all the pictures of Nikki and me have been removed from the walls and the mantle over the fireplace. I ask my mother where these pictures went. She tells me our house was burglarized a few weeks before I came home and the pictures were stolen. I ask why a burglar would want pictures of Nikki and me, and my mother says she puts all of her pictures in very expensive frames. Why didn't the burglar steal the rest of the family pictures? I ask. Mom says the burglar stole all the expensive frames, but she had the negatives for the family portraits and had them replaced. Why didn't you replace the pictures of Nikki and me? I ask. Mom says she did not have the negatives for the pictures of Nikki and me, especially because Nikki's parents had paid for the wedding pictures and had only given my mother copies of the photos she liked. Nikki had given Mom the other non-wedding pictures of us, and, well, we aren't in touch with Nikki or her family right now because it's a part-time. Notice that Quick does not try to convey what Pat is feeling in this farcical passage. There's no need. Pat's delusional refusal to accept that Nikki is not coming back to him is plainly evident. This objective, wry, reportorial approach serves Quick's purpose well, because if we were asked to swallow the inner emotional life of Pat Peoples, we couldn't. It's too crazy and painful. This is demonstrated again in the next chapter, when Pat, to fulfill a condition of his release, goes for his first appointment with his outside psychiatrist, Dr. Cliff Patel. As I sit there flipping through a Sports Illustrated, listening to the easy listening station Dr. Patel pumps into his waiting room, suddenly I'm hearing sexy synthesizer chords, faint hi-hat taps, the kick drum thumping out an erotic heartbeat, the twinkling of fairy dust, and then the evil, bright soprano saxophone. You know the title, Songbird. And I'm out of my seat, screaming, kicking chairs, flipping the coffee table, picking up piles of magazines, and throwing them against the wall, yelling, "It's not fair! I won't tolerate any tricks! I'm not an emotional lab rat!" And then a small Indian man, maybe only 5 feet tall, wearing a cable-knit sweater in August, suit pants, and shiny white tennis shoes, is calmly asking me what's wrong. "Turn off that music," I yell. "Shut it off, right now." The tiny man is Dr. Patel, I realize, because he tells his secretary to turn off the music, and when she obeys, Kenny G is out of my head and I stop yelling. I cover my face with my hand so no one will see my crying, and after a minute or so, my mother begins rubbing my back. So much silence. And then Dr. Patel asks me into his office. I follow him reluctantly as Mom helps the secretary clean up the mess I made. His office is pleasantly strange. What is Pat feeling? Quick doesn't report that because it doesn't matter. What matters is what readers feel, which perhaps is shock, horror, or even compassion for a guy who obviously is in distress. I find Kenny G's greatest hits somewhat saccharine, I'll admit, but hardly a reason to overturn coffee tables. Showing is all that's needed here. That's important to remember if your characters are dark, tormented, suffering, or insane. The painful emotional lives of such characters need to become tolerable for readers. Humor and objective showing create a safety zone. In that zone, readers can process their own response to emotional conditions that are extreme. To put it simply, when character emotions are highly painful, pull back. One secret ingredient behind effective showing can be summed up in this word, subtext. When there's a feeling we're not being told, but it is evident anyway, that underlying feeling is the subtext. It's the unspoken emotional truth. When we discern it, it's a surprise. The opening of Gregory David Roberts's The Mountain Shadow, 2015, his sequel to Shantaram, 2003, would seem to have plenty to surprise readers with. A mix of mysticism, crime, and romance, as well as its settings, the slums of Bombay. However, Roberts uses subtext in small ways throughout to keep us wondering about that which we aren't being told. In this early passage of dialogue, Roberts' Australian fugitive hero, Lynn, is walking away from an opium den and talking with two acquaintances, Vikram, for whom he has recently and violently reclaimed from a loan shark a necklace belonging to Vikram's mother, and Naveen, a would-be detective. They are the kinds of close friends that only people who share criminal records can be. Vikram was about to step into the taxi, but I stopped him, leaning in close to speak quietly.
What are you doing?
What do you mean?
You can't lie to me about drugs, Vic.
What lying? He protested.
Shit, I just add a few puffs of brown sugar, that's all. So what? It's Con Cannon stuff anyway. He paid for it.
Take it easy.
I always take it easy, you know me.
Some people can snap out of a habit, Vikram. Con Cannon might be one of them. You're not one of them. You know that.
He smiled, and for a few seconds, the old Vikram was there. The Vikram who would have gone to Goa for the necklace without any help from me or anyone else. The Vikram who wouldn't have left a piece of his mother's wedding jewelry with a loan shark in the first place. The smile folded from his eyes as he got into the taxi. I watched him away, worried for the danger in what he was, an optimist ruined by love. I started walking again, and Naveen fell in beside me.
He talks about that girl, the English girl, a lot, Naveen said.
It's one of those things that should have worked out but rarely do.
He talks about you a lot, too, Naveen said.
He talks too much.
He talks about Carla and Didier and Lisa, but mostly he talks about you.
He talks too much.
He told me that you escaped from prison, he said, and that you're on the run.
I stopped walking.
Now you're talking too much. What is this, an epidemic?
Whoa. What's up with Lynn? There's something about him we don't know, and that he'd obviously prefer we didn't. What does he feel? He isn't saying, but that's not important, or anyway, it's less important than what we feel when he abruptly turns on Naveen.
So what do we feel?
First of all, the moment is nicely set up for a reversal. Lynn cares enough about Vikram to caution him about drug use, which Vikram is prone to because of his sorrow over a lost love. However, it is Lynn who has the more dangerous criminal tendencies. He also has a lost love, his soulmate Carla, who is now married to a handsome Indian media tycoon. When Naveen mentions Lynn's fugitive status, Lynn goes on high alert. So do we. We don't know what Lynn feels, but we know what we feel. Watch out. The previous passage is a tiny passing moment in the opening of the mountain shadow. But this little jolt of discovery, of subtext, of showing, both gives us a shiver and contributes to an accretion of emotional splashes that, like waves, grow into a tsunami of tragic proportions. Lynn's story of must go, can't leave Bombay plays out with emotional force, but oftentimes that force is stealthy, sneaky, and unseen. Small doses of subtext sum up to a big effect. Showing isn't necessarily limited to external action or dialogue, or that which we can see or hear. Situations and conditions such as a state of being can be presented without emotions, and despite that, cause us to feel quite a bit. Examples of this can be found throughout the work of the grand master of showing, Ernest Hemingway. His take on fiction technique was simple. Find what gave you the emotion, what the action was that gave you the excitement, then write it down, making it clear, so the reader will see it too, and have the same feeling as you had. There you have it, the pithy advice left to us by one of the greatest writers of the 20th century. It sounds simple, and indeed, when Hemingway followed his own advice, the results were gripping. Here's the opening paragraph of Hemingway's short story, Now I Lay Me. That night we lay on the floor in the room, and I listened to the silkworms eating. The silkworms fed in racks of mulberry leaves, and all night you could hear them eating, and a dropping sound in the leaves. I myself did not want to sleep because I had been living for a long time with the knowledge that if I ever shut my eyes in the dark and let myself go, my soul would go out of my body.
I had been that way for a long time, ever since I had been blown up at night, and felt it go out of me, and go off and then come back. I tried never to think about it, but it had started to go since, in the nights, just at the moment of going off to sleep, and I could only stop it by a very great effort. So while I am now fairly sure that it would not really have gone out, yet then, that summer, I was unwilling to make the experiment. Note the type of showing that Hemingway is using. This isn't action per se. This is the inner state of a man suffering from sleeplessness. He's a victim of shell shock, now called post-traumatic stress disorder. He recalls an out-of-body experience, something that Hemingway himself experienced in World War I. What about Hemingway's style? Is it literary? Hardly. Not with all that plain language and those clunky compound sentences. Not a fancy word in sight, either. Imagery? The gnawing silkworms are unusual. They provide the intrigue that at the outset hooks us into his story. Now, as you read that passage, what do you feel? For me, the passage is plain, even awkward, yet arresting. What I feel is something like compassion, quiet horror, and helplessness rolled up into one. There is suffering. This is a soldier burdened by the after effects of war. The terror of the out-of-body experience he underwent gnaws at him as surely as the silkworms gnaw at the leaves. Hemingway's passage does not tell you what the point of view character feels. As Hemingway intended, he merely creates the experience, and we in turn feel something. But here's the thing. The experience that Hemingway creates is not a mundane, day-to-day washing of dishes or making tea. It's not just any garden-variety insomnia. This ex-soldier is haunted by a brush with death itself. Hemingway did not ask us to be gripped by domestic trivialities. He wrote about big stuff. And that's my point. Lying awake at night is not by itself going to cause readers to feel anything. Only when a situation has heavy emotional baggage will readers pick up that baggage and carry it. But what about small stuff, you may be asking? How do some authors entrance us with what seems mundane? Good question. Anthony Doerr's bestseller, All the Light We Cannot See, 2014, emphatically is a literary novel. Doerr places high value on language, imagery, and moments. Looked at structurally, it's like a collection of literary postcards. It's not built of scenes that enact change, so much as moments with meaning, slices of reality that illuminate the condition of his characters. The novel is set during World War II, but circles back to the 1930s and the earlier lives of Doerr's two protagonists, a young German soldier and a blind French girl. The girl, Marie Laure, grows up in Paris where her father works in a museum of natural history. Stored in this museum is a diamond that is said to be cursed. As the museum prepares to put this diamond on display, superstition and anxiety run rampant. In this passage, a colleague of Marie Laure's father tries to reassure her. Dr. Geffard's answers are hardly better. You know how diamonds, how all crystals grow, Laurette. By adding microscopic layers, a few thousand atoms every month, each atop the next, millennia after millennia. That's how stories accumulate, too. All the old stones accumulate stories. That little rock you're so curious about may have seen Alaric sack Rome. It may have glittered in the eyes of pharaohs. Scythian queens might have danced all night wearing it. Wars might have been fought over it. Papa says curses are only stories cooked up to deter thieves. He says there are 65 million specimens in this place, and if you have the right teacher, each can be as interesting as the last. Still, he says, certain things compel people. Pearls, for example, and sinistral shells, shells with a left-hand opening. Even the best scientists feel the urge now and then to put something in a pocket. That something so small could be so beautiful, worth so much, Only the strongest people can turn away from feelings like that.
They are quiet for a moment.
Marie Laure says, I heard that a diamond is like a piece of light from the original world before it fell, a piece of light rained to earth from God.
You want to know what it looks like? That's why you're so curious.
She rolls a murex in her hands, holds it to her ear. 10,000 drawers, 10,000 whispers inside 10,000 shells.
No, she said. I want to believe that Papa hasn't been anywhere near it.
Squint and you'd almost think that Dore is writing about literary fiction. That something so small could be so beautiful, only the strongest people can turn away from feelings like that. Actually, Dore is writing about museum specimens. The passage is packed with sparkling imagery, gems, geology, curses. So how does that imagery itself cause us to feel?
It doesn't. It can't. What causes us to feel something is a blind daughter's worry over her father.
Pearls and sistral shells? Pretty images, yes, but not as effective as a single strong feeling.
Emotional Mastery 1. Effective Showing.
Select a moment in your story when your protagonist is moved, unsettled, or disturbed. This might occur when he's facing a difficult choice, needing something badly, suffering a setback or surprise, having a self-realization, learning something shocking, or feeling in any way overwhelmed. Write down all the emotions inherent in this moment, both obvious and hidden. Next, considering what he is feeling, write down how your protagonist can act out. What is the biggest thing your protagonist can do? What would be explosive, out of bounds, or offensive? What would be symbolic? What can your protagonist say that would cut right to the heart of the matter or unite others in understanding? Go sideways, underneath, or ahead? How can your protagonist show us a feeling that we don't expect to see? Add a detail of the setting that only your protagonist would notice, or that everyone notices but your protagonist sees in a unique way. Finally, go back and delete all the emotions you wrote down at the beginning of this exercise. Let actions and spoken words do the work. Do they feel too big, dangerous, or over the top? Use them anyway. Others will tell you if you've gone too far, but more likely, you haven't gone far enough. By the way, before we leave Hemingway, it's often said that he hated writing about emotions. That's not wholly true. He could brilliantly capture pure emotion, as he did in this passage from his story, In Another Country, which concerns a soldier undergoing rehabilitation in a hospital in Milan for an injury to his knee. Several other wounded Italian soldiers are also undergoing treatment. The boys at first were very polite about my medals and asked me what I had done to get them. I showed them the papers, which were written in very beautiful language and full of fratellanza and abnegazione, but which really said, with the adjectives removed, that I had been given the medals because I was an American. After that, their manner changed a little toward me, although I was their friend against outsiders. I was a friend, but I was never really one of them after they had read the citations, because it had been different with them, and they had done very different things to get their medals. I had been wounded, it was true, but we all knew that being wounded, after all, was really an accident. I was never ashamed of the ribbons, though, and sometimes after the cocktail hour, I would imagine myself having done all the things they had done to get their medals, but walking home at night through the empty streets and with the cold wind, and all the shops closed, trying to keep near the streetlights, I knew that I would never have done such things, and that I was very much afraid to die, and often lay in bed at night by myself, afraid to die, and wondering how I would be when I went back to the front again. Afraid to die. You don't get much more direct than that. Direct and plain emotions stated like this don't often have a strong effect. But they do in this case, I think, because we're already gripped by an earlier, unspoken emotion. Shame, That has opened us up, put us in an emotional groove. The blunt sentiment, afraid to die, then hits like a cymbal crash at the end of a measure. When showing has an impact, it is because the action is freighted with feelings in the first place. You're probably not going to get much emotional mileage out of pouring a bowl of cereal, tidying up the house, or in other ways portraying everyday realism. When that does work, it's because large emotions are already there. Inner mode. Telling. Writing out what characters feel ought to be a shortcut to getting readers to feel that stuff too, shouldn't it? You'd think so. After all, it's through characters that we experience a story. Their experience is ours. Actually, the truth is the opposite. Put on the page what a character feels, and there's a pretty good chance that paradoxically, what the reader will feel is nothing. Here's an example. His guts twisted in fear. When you read that, do your own guts twist in fear? Probably not. Or this. Her eyes shot daggers at him. Do you feel simmering rage? Meh, not so much. Such feelings fail to excite us because, of course, we've read them too many times. Those daggers have dulled. What gets readers going are feelings that are fresh and unexpected. Yet those feelings also need to be real and true, otherwise they will come across as contrived. They'll ring false and fail to ignite the reader's emotions. Skillful authors play against expected feelings. They go down several emotional layers in order to bring up emotions that will catch readers by surprise. There's always a different emotion to use. A story situation is an emotional elephant. There are many ways of looking at and feeling about what's happening at any given moment. Stop your story at any point. Ask the point of view character what she is feeling, and it's never just one answer. Ask two characters what they feel about what's happening, and neither will ever say the same thing. Human beings are complex. We have emotions on the surface and emotions underneath. There are emotions that we minimize, hide, and deny. There are emotions that embarrass us, reveal too much, and make us vulnerable. Our emotions can be profoundly trivial or so elevated that they're silly. What we feel is inescapably influenced by our history, morals, loyalties, and politics. Our feelings are also communal. We pick up on others. We can project feelings that are mean, selfish, and destructive onto others. We can reserve feelings that are noble, selfless, and bold for ourselves. We laugh at funerals and cry at weddings. We're clear, we're vague, we hate, we love. We feel passionately about our shoes, yet shrug off disasters on TV. We are finely tuned sensors of right and wrong and horrible examples for our kids. We are walking contradictions. We are encyclopedias of the heart. Our feelings are also dynamic. They change. They can reverse in an instant. We can be torn, confused, and frustrated, which only means that our feelings are in conflict. We can be stuck, shut down, apathetic, or a mess. We can be dead inside or newly alive. We experience awakenings, self-awareness, hope, and joy. With so much rich human material to work with, it's disappointing to me that so many manuscripts offer a limited menu of emotions. I want to feast on life, but instead I'm standing before a fast food menu. My choice is limited to two patties or one, fries, medium or large. That is to say, I see a menu of simple, primary emotions. Other manuscripts show off, strive for effect, or so wildly elaborate characters' feelings that I feel like a visitor at a gallery of impenetrable modern art. I can't connect. The feelings that writers first choose to write are often obvious, easy, and safe. These are the feelings writers believe they ought to use if their stories are going to sell. They work only with primary emotions because that is what everyone feels, which is true, but this is also a limited view. So how does one create emotional surprise? Is it possible to be both artful and accessible? Can emotions feel right and connect with us even when we don't see them coming? Certainly. Let's start with an example from a master of secondary emotions, Ray Bradbury. In Fahrenheit 451, Guy Montag is a futuristic fireman who burns books. He enjoys his job until he meets a 17-year-old girl who awakens his mind. After his transformation begins, he's called to help burn a house full of books, and Montag secretly takes one. The house and its contents are then doused with kerosene. The woman who lives in the house is warned to leave, but refuses and holds up an ordinary kitchen match. The sight of it rushed the men out and down away from the house. Captain Beatty, keeping his dignity, backed slowly through the front door, his pink face burnt and shiny from 1,000 fires and night excitements. God, thought Montag, how true. Always at night the alarm comes, never by day. Is it because fire is prettier by night? More spectacle? A better show? The pink face of Beatty now showed the faintest panic in the door. The woman's hand twitched on the single matchstick. The fumes of kerosene bloomed up about her. Montag felt the hidden book pound like a heart against his chest. A careless writer would have focused on Montag's horror at what was about to happen. No, don't do it. Bradbury, however, knows that the obvious emotion will not have the desired effect. Instead, he portrays a feeling that we don't expect. Montag's excitement. Excitement? Remember that Montag is a fireman who has enjoyed starting fires. He knows the thrill of watching books burn. The expression on the face of his chief, Beatty, ignites that feeling again, briefly, even while Montag's heart is changing. Because Bradbury goes sideways from an expected feeling, we cannot help but feel something ourselves. In this horrific situation, we are forced to measure Montag's emotion against our own. How can we not? Is his excitement what we would feel? No. Or maybe yes, if we were Montag. Bradbury wasn't the first to figure this out. Literary greats like Hardy, Wharton, Forsyth, Lawrence, and many others knew that writing about emotions is as necessary a narrative as writing about anything else. They also understood that to be effective, writing about emotions has to be artful, which is another way of saying surprising. One of Daphne du Maurier's less often read but eminently worthwhile novels is My Cousin Rachel, 1951, which is about young and headstrong Philip Ashley, who has been raised by his beloved cousin Ambrose, a confirmed bachelor. When, for health reasons, Ambrose must winter in Italy, Philip is devastated but must stay behind to manage Ambrose's estate, which he will presumably someday inherit. All is miserable in Ambrose's absence, and then comes an even greater blow, a letter breaking to Philip the news that Ambrose has met, fallen in love with, and married a distant cousin of theirs, the vivacious but mysterious Rachel. Du Maurier plays the moment this way. The letter came about 5:30, just after I had dined. Luckily, I was alone. Seacombe had brought in the post bag and left it with me. I put the letter in my pocket and walked out across the fields down to the sea. Seacombe's nephew, who had the mill cottage on the beach, said good day to me. He had his net spread on the stone wall, drying in the last of the sun. I barely answered him, and he must have thought me curt. I climbed over the rocks to a narrow ledge, jutting into the little bay, where I used to swim in summer. Ambrose would anchor some 50 yards out in his boat, and I would swim to him. I sat down, and taking the letter from my pocket, read it again. If I could have felt one spark of sympathy, of gladness, one single ray of warmth towards those two who were sharing happiness together down in Naples, it would have eased my conscience. Ashamed of myself, bitterly angry at my selfishness, I could raise no feeling in my heart at all. I sat there, numb with misery, staring at the flat, calm sea. I had just turned 23, and yet I felt as lonely and as lost as I had done years before, sitting on a bench in fourth form at Harrow, with no one to befriend me and nothing before me, only a new world of strange experience that I did not want. Philip's selfish misery at Ambrose's news would be hard to take. Why isn't it? Philip is ashamed of himself. He knows he should feel happy for Ambrose and Rochelle, but cannot find a shred of gladness in his heart. Nevertheless, there is no other way to feel. He is once again an orphan, abandoned by his caretaker, and sent away to boarding school. It is a lonely experience.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.